We pollute, you pay. Anger as water companies promise to cut sewage spills by putting up bills. They apologised for not tackling the problem sooner and said they were ready to spend £10 billion fixing it. But critics say they should pay, not us.
Consumers have already paid. You know, since privatisation, £72 billion has been taken out of the water industry in dividend payments that should have been used to put right the system. So we believe in a cost of living crisis for the government to make sure that consumers are protected.
Also this lunchtime, what happened to Harry in New York? The latest on allegations the King's son was chased by photographers.
Their driver was making it a catastrophic experience. If they were going 80 miles an hour, I would have probably be going about 20 miles an hour behind them.
The latest on the fatal floods across northern Italy and the Balkans. No Wi-Fi, how a million people have cut off their broadband because they can't afford to be online. And
you'll remember me when the west wind moves upon the field.
Sting becomes a songwriter who will never be forgotten with a very special Ivor Novello Award.
This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Nina Hussain.
Good afternoon. Sorry, not sorry. Water companies in England have apologised for not acting quickly enough to tackle raw sewage spilling into rivers and seas. They've also promised a £10 billion investment to try to fix the problem. But there's anger after they admitted the public would pay towards those improvements through years of higher bills. Our political correspondent Shihab Khan has the details and the reaction.
For years, contaminated water has been pumped into our rivers and seas and has washed up on our beaches. Untreated sewage polluting our waters all over the country. It's been happening here at this river in Yorkshire where people often swim. The Environment Agency has said the water quality is so bad they advise people don't use it. And Dailuri has been campaigning for change.
That area there, past that bridge, is just not safe to swim in at all because there's a large amount of untreated sewage goes in there from one of the combined sewage outflows. And also, the sewage that is treated is not treated effectively.
Today, after significant campaigning, the big water companies finally apologised and vowed to modernise their systems.
I'm here today on behalf of the water industry to say sorry. I think we've listened, we've heard. We understand the upset that has been caused and the anger that people feel. This is clearly not something that we can put right overnight. We're very, very clear about this, but we want to start making a huge difference. This will take time. It will take, far more than this 1 5-year period, but you can see the sort of transformation that we're making during that time.
It is a £10 billion project that will take decades, but there's pressure on the government to make sure things change quickly.
Actually, what we've done is unveiled the issue. It's become very clear. We'd already started taking some action on this with the £56 billion storm overflow reduction plan. I've insisted to water companies that by the end of June, I want an action plan for every single storm overflow so that we can really get to grips and get these things
fixed. But you're basically
saying
we have to wait till 2050 to properly fix this?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily.
But big water companies have made huge profits. United Utilities registered £610 million of profit in 2022. Severn Trent Water, £476 million. Anglian Water, just over £440 million. And Thames Water on £429 million. But there are concerns that it will be customers who have to pay for the modernisation through higher bills.
Consumers have already paid. You know, since privatisation, £72 billion has been taken out of the water industry in dividend payments that should have been used to put right the system. So we believe in a cost of living crisis for the government to make sure that consumers are protected.
Pressure is on the water companies to clean up their act, and they'll be judged by how quickly they do it.
Shihab, what more has the government had to say about this today?
Yeah, we've heard from both Number 10 and the Water Minister today. They say this is welcome news, that the apology has finally come, but that more work needs to be done. You heard in my report about the government targets that have been set on this. They want to end sewage dumping by the year 2050. The data does show that the figures have been going up in recent years, that more and more sewage has been being pumped in to waters. And the government has been criticised for that. But their defence of that is it is because there are now more monitoring positions in place. The monitoring wasn't being done to the level that it needed to be done. There's also another target to have monitors at all storm overflows by the end of this year. They say that's the reason why we're actually aware of this problem. It is going to take some time. This is a multi-decade issue. This is a infrastructure project that, as you heard in that report, the target is set for 2050. Now, the Liberal Democrats, who have been campaigning on this a lot, have been critical of the government. They say that this could happen much quicker. As you saw, the profits of those water companies are extremely large. The Liberal Democrats are saying that the CEOs of those companies should give their bonuses back until this issue is resolved. It is one of those things that we aren't going to have an answer for quite some time. So we've got years to wait until we finally see the impact of this.
Shihab Khan, thank you very much. Thank you. A photographer has blamed Harry and Meghan's driver for the catastrophic experience in New York after the couple left a theatre. The King's son and his wife said they were in relentless pursuit after leaving an event on Tuesday night. The couple were first driven by their driver, then swapped to a taxi. The city's mayor said it would be horrific for Harry to be involved in an accident similar to the one that killed his mother in 1997. Ellie Pitt has our report.
New and conflicting details this morning about what happened to Prince Harry and Meghan Markle on the street.
In the hours after the Duke and Duchess of Sussex released details of what they described as a car chase through the streets of New York, eyewitnesses have emerged questioning the severity of the danger they were in on Tuesday night. One of the paparazzi pack that followed Harry and Meghan told Good Morning Britain it was the couple's driver who made the situation dangerous.
There was zigzagging, there was cutting off, there was like coming super close to the cars, squeezing, wedging.
The pair were in the city for an awards ceremony, but stepped out of the event into the chaos of flashing lights and photographers. To avoid the press knowing where they were staying, the couple drove around Manhattan. But this became what they called in their statement a near catastrophic car chase at the hands of a ring of highly aggressive paparazzi. This relentless pursuit, lasting over 2 hours, resulted in multiple near collisions. But paparazzi pursuing a royal car through city streets at night has haunting echoes of the Paris tunnel crash that caused the death of Harry's mother, Princess Diana. Today, her personal protection officer was scathing of the decisions made by the Sussex's security team.
The security should have managed that exit properly to give these paparazzi a photograph and then, you know, sort of move on, just to rather head off from the hotel in this sort of catch-me-if-you-can chase. Never, ever works.
Today, the Queen continued her royal duties at a school near Bristol. A Sussex's biographer said they hadn't heard from any of the royal family after their ordeal last night.
I think this is the element of the day that has surprised me the most. Hearing this story would have no doubt stirred some kind of emotional response, and so I was really shocked to hear from sources that neither Harry nor Meghan had heard from any members of the royal family.
Just as the Sussexes have had to navigate their new roles outside the royal family, they'll need to steer their way through the media and public spotlight that shows no sign of dimming. Ellie Pitt, ITV News.
Our US correspondent Dan Rivers joins us now from New York. Dan, how do we reconcile some differing versions of events here?
Yeah, it is a bit puzzling, isn't it? There's sort of two conflicting accounts of what went wrong here. On the one hand, the photographers, as you heard in that report, claiming, in fact, it was Harry and Meghan's driver that was doing all the aggressive driving. And then Harry and Meghan's statement yesterday saying it was the other way around, that they were being pursued, relentlessly pursued, and there was a near catastrophic collision. Look, Backgrid, this freelance photography association, has put out a statement this morning which gives a bit more detail. It's saying that there were four photographers involved. Three were in cars, one was on a bicycle. And they're saying that they have a professional responsibility to cover newsworthy events. They also claim that Meghan was smiling during part of this pursuit and that there were no near crashes. But they do add that they are coordinating an investigation and taking these allegations seriously. I suppose ultimately we may find that there's enough CCTV around New York to prove one way or the other who was in the wrong.
You would expect. Dan Rivers, thank you very much. Thank you. A man has admitted to abducting an 11-year-old girl while dressed as a woman before sexually assaulting her at his home in the Borders. Andrew Miller pleaded guilty to four charges at Edinburgh High Court, as well as sexual assault and abduction. The 53-year-old admitted to possessing indecent photographs of children and intentionally causing a child under 13 to look at a sexual image. The court was told that Miller was in the process of transitioning to female but chose to be identified by his birth name. Miller also goes by the name Amy George. The Prime Minister responded today from the warning from the owners of Vauxhall, who threatened to pull out of the UK because of looming Brexit trade tariffs. Rishi Sunak, who's on a visit to Japan, said his government is engaged in a dialogue with the EU over new taxes, which will be imposed from January, on electric vehicles.
Well, on this particular issue, it's something that car manufacturers across Europe, not just in the UK, have raised as a concern. And as a result of that, we are engaged in a dialogue with the EU about how we might address those concerns.
Now, two other big car makers have joined the owners of Vauxhall and called on the government to act. Ford, which has a factory on Merseyside, asked for an extension to the current rules. And Jaguar Land Rover also wants changes. Well, let's go live now to Japan and join our political editor, Robert Peston, who's travelling with the Prime Minister and is in Hiroshima. Robert, the pressure being piled on the Prime Minister now by the car industry.
That's certainly right. And it's another instance of what some would say, the sort of absurd claim by the previous Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, that he had got Brexit done, because it's another instance where the trade deal that he signed, according to the new-ish Prime Minister Rishi Sunak, needs renegotiating. And the reason for that is this. Under that deal, from the beginning of next year, unless a very significant proportion of the bits of an electric vehicle made in the UK, those bits are also made in the UK, then these tariffs are going to be imposed. And indeed, the conditions become even more onerous in 2027. That's why you're hearing the likes of Stellantis and Vauxhall saying, unless there is something, unless there's a renegotiation and those tariffs are either waived for years, they would say, they will simply relocate their plants somewhere else in the world where these tariffs don't apply on sales to what is an enormous market, the European single market. Now, the Prime Minister said, and you just heard him, that this is not something that just UK-based businesses have an interest in. It is certainly true that German-based car manufacturers, which have operations over here, would also like to see these rules amended. But we just don't know whether the European Union is going to play ball. And as we know, with these sorts of negotiations, there's always tit for tat. And we don't actually know what the European Union will want in return if the Prime Minister gets his way. Here I am in Hiroshima, where the Prime Minister is talking to world leaders and indeed to the Prime Minister of Japan tonight, all about improving the resilience of our sorts of economies. But it shows yet again how, in some ways, vulnerable our economy is.
Robert, thank you very much. Thank you. Still to come, pulling the plug for people who can no longer afford broadband. And thank you for your music. Sting gets an historic award for songwriting. First, more than 10,000 people have now fled their homes in northern Italy because of the floods there that have killed 9 people. Rescue teams are still trying to reach some towns and villages that are cut off from the roads, electricity and phone service. The extreme weather has also hit the Balkans. Faye Barker has the latest.
In just 36 hours, parts of northern Italy had half of the amount of rain they'd usually get in a year, leaving at least 9 people dead and thousands forced from their homes. On the streets of Faenza today, the damage following the deluge. Rescue workers continue to reach those who are stranded, whether it's by air or wading through the muddy waters that now engulf the streets. Torrential rain battered the Emilia-Romagna region for 2 days, causing over 100 landslides and more than a dozen rivers to burst their banks. Floods have also affected areas in southeastern Europe. This part of the River Una along the border of Croatia and Bosnia has risen so high, this man explains that stairs he usually walks on are now 4 metres below the water's surface. This is why we panic, he says. In this nearby Bosnian village, rescue workers deliver aid by boat to those stranded in their homes. Parts of northern Serbia have been affected too, with floods causing havoc on the streets, poor infrastructures being made worse by the deluge, and homes left without clean water. Some have described the weather conditions as apocalyptic, with scientists pointing towards the effects of climate change. The worst of the rain may have passed for now, but the cost of the cleanup in northern Italy alone has been put at 2 billion euros. Faye Barker, ITV News.
The S Club 7 star Paul Cattermole died of natural causes, according to a coroner's report. The 46-year-old was found dead at his home in Dorset last month. He was due to tour with the band. BT is going to axe up to 55,000 jobs by the end of the decade, mostly in the UK. Around a fifth of those cuts will come in customer services, as staff are replaced by technologies, including artificial intelligence. And the sale of super noodles has soared because of the cost of living crisis. Premier Foods, which produces the instant meal, says customers are increasingly turning to affordable ranges. Now, can you imagine a life without Wi-Fi? Well, that is the reality for a growing number of people who say they can't afford it anymore. New figures show that's around 1 million people. The government says there is support for people if they're struggling with broadband bills, but those who are not online say it's impacting work, homework and staying in touch with friends and family. Andrew Misra has more.
Could you live without broadband?
Probably not, no. Lowry's a single mum on universal credit. Her daughter relies on the internet to do her homework. Recently, though, the bill for their broadband tripled. But Lowry says they can't afford to do without it.
The world we live in at the moment, broadband's essential for everybody, especially the way life, we're all getting pushed in the direction of going online, you know, bills online, paperless. Educationally, kids have homework. Kids have to do research online. It's not even something you can think of counselling.
But many are. According to Citizens Advice, more than 1 million people disconnected their broadband last year because they couldn't afford it. Of those, 27% found it difficult to keep in touch with family and friends, and more than a quarter struggled to find work after it was cut. Those on universal credit were more than 6 times more likely to have their internet cut off. To help people on benefits, the government, along with the regulator Ofcom, point to the introduction of discounted social broadband tariffs, but take-up is low at around 5%.
We reckon it would save people who are eligible for them, on average, £200 a year, which would make a huge difference to their ability to make ends meet. The problem is that people just don't know about them because firms aren't doing enough to proactively get in touch with their customers and make sure they're on the best deals. That's what needs to change.
Until it does, the fear is that more and more people like Lowry could soon become cut off from society. Andrew Mesra, ITV News.
Finally, the former teacher who's being honoured with one of the music industry's highest accolades, Sting, will today join an elite club of stars to receive an Ivor Novello Fellowship for his songwriting, both as a solo artist and with his band, The Police.
You forget the sun in his jealous sky as we walk in fields of gold.
Our entertainment reporter Rishi Davda is on the red carpet ahead of those awards later this afternoon and just sent this.
Well, Sting is best known for the 4 or 5 minute songs that we all get to hear, but hours and hours of work go into the creative process, and the Ivors is all about celebrating that work. Songwriters and screen composers. Now, many have picked up an Ivor statue in the past, some of the industry's greats. I'm thinking of Sir Paul McCartney, Adele and Amy Winehouse. Today, Sting is being honoured with a fellowship, the Academy's highest honour. Now, despite having sold 100 million albums, both as a solo artist and with The Police, he says there's no specific science to songwriting.
The actual process itself is very mysterious. I don't quite know how it happens. I wish I did. I wish I knew the formula, but I don't, and I probably never will. But it's a mystery that I'm happy to be swimming in, if you know what I mean.
Harry Styles is up for 3 awards at the Ivors too. He's had a meteoric rise off his most recent album, achieving great success at both the Grammys and the Brit Awards. Ray is nominated for Best Contemporary Song for Escapism. Many are using her as a leading example of the success that can be achieved after going independent as an artist. Now, interestingly, of these 72 individual songwriters and composers nominated here today, more than half are first-time nominees, showing that the Ivors is as much about celebrating new talent as it is honouring the industry's greats.
Rishi Davda reporting. Mary's here at 6:30 from me and the lunchtime team. Bye-bye.